the presentation Transforming IT in Digital Age with IT4IT by Mr. Prasanna Anantharamaiah. Prasanna is a Cloud Chief Technologist at Hewlett Packard Enterprise. In his role, Prasanna engages with large enterprises on their IT transformation projects, focusing on cloud-first and mobile-first initiatives. Prasanna comes with over 25 years of experience and specializes in cloud service delivery platform, enterprise IT services management. His research interests include hybrid cloud management, IT organizational models, and cloud security. Prasanna holds 5 US patents and is an Open Group Certified Distinguished Architect and serves as a member of the certification boards. Welcome, Prasanna. Over to you.
Thank you. Thank you. I know that I'm the last one in the presentation, and I'll try to make it interesting by showing a little bit of demo as well. I know there was a good discussion that happened on what is IT4IT and how TOGAF is related to IT. Bill did a good job in trying to really relate these two together. I know that there are a little bit of questions still remaining. Hopefully, I'll try to, my presentation might answer some of them. If not, we can definitely have some of those questions answered. The idea of this presentation was basically we are going through the digital transformation that we heard in the morning. It's initiated through Andhra Pradesh in the state government, but that is going at the national level as well. That's happening from a government. And imagine if from the government, if it's happening, and the impact that it would have on the enterprises as well. So there's going to be a huge transformations that is going to be happening in the business or enterprise. If you look at enterprise as a government, enterprises as business units as well, the businesses as well. So the impact of those business transformation, how it's going to be impacting the IT organization, the IT function within the government and within the enterprises or within these businesses. So that's the objective, you know, how do we really transform the IT itself to really make this digital, digital India or digital transformation that is happening. That's the whole objective. I'll try to address some of those. Some of the activities that you've currently been working as an architect, as an IT organization, might reflect that, okay, this is what actually I'm doing. So if you look at it from an IT for IT, it's quite possible that some of the activities that you are doing fits in into those value streams that Bill talked about. So that's what I would reflect as well. A little, you know, let me just go into the change that is happening. We heard a lot since the morning. In fact, you know, the changes that is happening as a part of digital transformation. In fact, the Digital India, power to empower, setting up the infrastructure for empowering the citizen, empowering the business, which is a fantastic tag and a fantastic initiative the Government of India is initiating. And the reasons, if you are saying this transformation, is twofold. One is from an outside-in perspective. The changes that is happening because of this transformation in the users, you know, in the end user community, the users of these technology, users of those services, that is driving the transformation in the business as well as in the government. And at the same time, we heard in the morning, in ETAL, there are around 3,500 or services that are there. And out of that, 30 to 40%, I know Pallab indicated that it's nearly 60% are duplicated. So how do we really bring in the efficiency from inside, you know, trying to look at it from inside organization, how do I really bring in the efficiency so that without compromising the service that I'm going to give it to the end customers or the user, I can bring in the efficiency so I can be profitable as well. That's the whole changes that you can read this. These are coming from the Gartner statistics. The changes are driving. So what we saw in the morning, you know, the three major initiatives, one from the connectivity to the end users, that's happening as a part of Digital India initiative, which is like more than a lakh of post offices are now enabled with the digital post office or the digital IT enabled. And then you have in the center that the infrastructure from a perspective of whether it is Aadhaar card or it's the DigiLocker Beam is the new application that is coming up. So this is enabling the end user to really bring changes. You know, they'll start looking for more. And at the end, the infrastructure from either it's a BSNL or the IT, the telecom infrastructure that's connecting, with providing that infrastructure for this IT services to be enabled. If you want to just see the changes that is happening, just a question over here. How many of you have registered for Reliance Jio? Not much, but the way if you want to register today to get this SIM card, it would be a little shocking because, you know, my maid servant, just last week, she came because her brother who's just passed 10th standard, and he is one of the salesperson. He comes with a Samsung phone, which is attached to it is a fingerprint, fingerprint reader. So you press a fingerprint, specify your Aadhaar card number, boom, he will give you the SIM card. All KYC is done. Imagine the kind of changes that's coming up. Specifically on one of these, getting access to mobile service itself. That's the kind of changes that is being brought through. Taking the same example, I'm not marketing for the Jio in any case, but at the same time, what customer is looking at, what is useful in here is, it's a better service that they are going to be providing. They are giving us free of cost in March, and they are extending up to probably June. Free calls, that's a better service. It's a faster service. They'll be giving you a 4G with 1 GB data per day free of cost. And then it's cheaper as well as it's safer as well. Now the idea of this is the way that the customer is asking for in a new world, in a new transformed world. And the another example that I would like to give, you know, how many of you are traveling in metro, Bangalore metro? There will, I'm sure, but other metros as well across there. So you have the analogy that you can bring in is the better, faster, safer, and cheaper holds good for providing these kind of services which are significantly IT enabled. There's a lot of IT that gets into providing this service. So the idea is, when we are talking about why IT4IT has come in, the reason is most of this business requires a lot of IT capability, and the IT needs to really transform. And that's the reason when you see IT4IT, it's basically, one of the questions that was asked is, yes, this is very specific for running a business of IT. And that's the standard that came up. There was another question that was asked which was related to the bimodal IT. Yes, there is a significant amount of traditional IT that remains in the organization, in the government, which cannot be really changed. That means that part can be changed over a period of time. But till then you need to have certain capability which is agile in the new digital world. How do you need to really manage the changes? You know, how do we really adapt? So then IT, in short term, need to form that bridge. Now, how you can really form the bridge between the traditional IT to a new generation IT. And that's the objective with which the idea for IT standards are also evolving. So the lot of initiatives that would get originated to really meet the requirements of the digital transformation or the IT transformations that are required to meet the digital transformation, you would have DevOps, you would have cloud, you have initiatives that are related to security, there are processes that are changing, there are tools that are getting changed. You have architectures that are really used, architectural frameworks, standards that are in place to really build individual pieces. But how does this, all of these pieces would fit together? How does this whole puzzle look together from a top-down approach, you know, for an organization like, you know, somebody at a chief minister level or at a CIO's or CEO's level? How do they really look at the organization? If you try to take the entire geograph architecture and a lot of these diagrams in an Archimedes form, you will probably not understand. There need to be a somewhat a simplified version of a top-down approach which a CIO can understand and see his whole entire IT organization, because IT is driving a lot of business. So he'll have to have an understanding of how IT itself is working. And IT for IT is the way that would paint that picture. Let me just go in here. So as you can see here, I don't know how much you can read it, but the idea, as James was talking about earlier, it was originated probably 5-6 years back in 2011 when HP, Shell, Accenture, there were quite a lot of these companies. They were really looking at grappling from the fact that a lot of IT projects have been initiated. What's the value that I'm getting out of these projects itself? You know, how do I really see the value from these projects? The other aspect is enterprise as architects. I know Yusuf from Swift Technology talked about what's the first thing that organization would want to invest in. They would like to invest in something that gives them a higher top line, right? So enterprise architecture is probably, yes, they know that, okay, it is going to be bringing that, but how does it really bring? What is the kind of tools that, as an architect, that I can make use to showcase that value stream? And showcase that, okay, here is where I fit in the entire organization, entire operating model, and this is what the value that I am bringing is. That's where I, you know, the research on the IT4IT started, and that's how the standard has been evolved. It basically two things that Bill has already talked about. It comes up with a value stream, which is the microcontrollers model, where an IT operating model with value streams clearly defined. These are the streams that will give you a maximum. You know, Michael Porter talked about in terms of in manufacturing industries, the margin that you can get. How do you maximize the margin? That means that bring in the efficiency in your entire operating model. That's the first part. The second part is very prescriptive. Here, the reference architecture that we talk about, it talks about purely on the functional level and at the information level. It doesn't go deeper than that. You can put in as a part of function whatever components or software component that you would want to do, you would want to introduce, but it remains at the functional level, and it also talks about how information is exchanged across the value stream. That goes deeper into the IT reference architecture. IT operating model will talk about how the IT is operating. You know, we talk about from an architecture point of view, yes, of course, TOGAF also talks about operations aspect of it, but end-to-end operating model in a simplified way is how the complementary aspect of TOGAF IT4IT is bringing it. Here you would see, this is in an IT, the rightmost portion is the supply chain, where it starts from the infrastructure and then the application and then system at the IT level and the business process. That I would call it as a supply chain. And then you have the value stream across strategy to portfolio, requirements to deploy. That's already, Bill had already touched about. The idea here is when we see what Mr. Satyanarayan in the morning talked about and Pallab talked about from an IT, e-Pragati enterprise architecture, very clear vision followed by an enterprise architecture which stayed at the functional level. Yes, they have gone deeper into a functional, dissecting the functional into a component level as well as the deeper functionality. But if you look at it, at the topmost level, it's the strategy is very, very clear. That strategy to coming out with a portfolio of services. Now, if I have a clear portfolio of services that I need to be delivering and a clear ownership for each one of the portfolios, you wouldn't probably have had that out of 3,600 services that has come, 60% would be duplicate. right? So that is the value stream, that value that an architecture can bring in. When you have a clear strategy to portfolio, when you have a clear ownership that is assigned to the portfolio of services that you are coming in, as a part of this value stream, you can showcase that this is where, as an architect, that I'm bringing value. Similarly, if you look at it from requirements to deploy, this is nothing but a deployment or on how you develop. We all talk about DevOps, we all talk about agile methodology. Where is the value that I'm bringing it across, and how I can really bring out the value? What are the KPIs that I can really measure and showcase that because I'm doing agile methodology, I can do a release of services much faster, which means that your time to market for business is going to be much faster. That's where I'm going to be bringing the value. So it's very clearly in each one of these value streams that you can highlight the value that you're bringing. As a next level, yes, we have other frameworks like TOGAF or SACMAN or other architectural methodology that you can really make use of it to crystallize things. The other thing that you would like to also see is, you know, what are the roles that IT is playing in the digital age, you know, in the digital transform? Let's go from the top to bottom, you know, because you see that power to empower Digital India, we talk, you know, it's empowering citizens, it's empowering businesses to create, it's empowering SMEs to really create a lot of new services. So in the new world, it's going to be more as a broker as a service, you know, broker, service brokering mechanism. You are basically coordinating and bringing services, you're creating a service delivery platform and delivering services to your customers or your citizens. That's going to be a significant role that an IT is going to be playing. And key thing that is important in that is how do you really govern those services? Govern the services that are coming from every individual service providers. And the providers who are providing those services, how do I really give that benefits of whatever changes that is coming in directly to the citizen? That kind of coordination, that kind of arbitration, service broking mechanism is one role that fits across the streams. You know, it need not be just at the service strategy level that I'm going to be deciding that, okay, it's going to be a broker solution and it's completely outsourced, I'm not going to be deploying. No, it's across all the streams. You need to really ensure that there is a clear thought through on the portfolio that you are bringing in as a part of a brokering. There is a clear how do you really integrate that and provide a common services as a part of your common portal without even probably exposing the service provider. It's coming from a service provider. Then you have to really look at how do you fulfill the service, how do you build the services. That's the third request to fulfill the value stream. And finally, how do you really manage the service level of every service provider? That's directly correct. Service broker, then you could also be as a role, you can also be a service developer. Nothing but that you are the one who are looking at from a requirements going through, you know, friend talked about ASMIC, creating the architecture diagram, then going through the implementation, creating those systems itself, and then providing the services. That's the developer. And then you can be a service provider in yourself. You know, you're providing services like a B2B service provider. So you are providing certain services to multiple other government agencies or multiple other business units itself or businesses itself. So that's the point. At the end, you need to also have an IT management capability. That means that you have the entire IT systems that are in place. How do you really manage these IT systems? Which is primarily looking at from making sure that the services are available, the services are high performing. That's the capability that you bring in as a part of management solutions. Now all these roles are necessary. So when you start looking at here is the IT4IT and here is how the different roles are. Now, what next that I need to really look at it? You know, how do I really start realizing my vision of IT4IT or the DOGAF architecture and try to really make things really happen? This is where you start looking at from a lens and then see, okay, what is it that I need to really focus on? The first and the foremost is the customer centric. You know, it's, you need to be, you cannot really get out of this customer centricity. So you'll have to really focus on customer providing either, you know, how the best experience that you have to provide to the end customer. And customers are going to be demanding, it's going to be demand that is coming from the top, which will make you really think about how you need to really run your IT organization. And what is he looking at it? At the cover, he's looking at, we talked about cheaper, faster, safer, and you know, better. That is what he's looking at. And you can look at from each one of them, what kind of KPIs that you need to really measure for each one of these benefits that he is looking at. From a implementation, when you start looking at from an implementation, let's assume that you are looking at a multi-source environment, so you are looking at as a service broker role, or you are looking at from a developer capability, service developer, or you want to really automate and make sure that things are much automated, or you are to really bring in security, you can try to drill down and then see how IT4IT would really help in each one of these areas. So as you can see from the top, I'm not sure if you can read this here, but let me try to read it, some of them for you. So at the top, if you have this lens that you're looking at it, and then you are looking at how this lens would really fit in into some of the high level use cases. In here, either as a service broker, service developer, and service provider, for each one of those value streams, there's a demand that is coming from an end customer that says that, for example, in service strategy and portfolio for a service broker, in this section, let me just read it out. I want to decide between build, buy, or broker to deliver the services. I means that this is what the an IT CIO is asking, that this is what I would want to do it. Or it's an end customer that is looking at it and asking for this. The last one, which is on the same broker level at the detect to correct level, he's looking at, I want to manage suppliers to deliver and deliver rapid and effective resolution of all the problems that I have. Now, if you see that at a service broker level, you have a very high level requirements that is coming. And for each one of these requirements, you would have a set of use cases that you can derive. I'll take you through some of the examples as well, but looking at from, because we see the broker is going to be the way that things are going to be happening as a part of IT, governance and service delivery, integrating all the services. I'll take an example of how the brokering can really work, specifically in the cloud side. But the idea here is, when you look at from a service broker point of view, you have selected that this is the use cases at a high level that you would want to address. And you can clearly drill down further what kind of use cases that you would want to address for each one of those values. Now, where did these requirements actually originate? These are basically working with various different customers that HP has worked out, and then find out that, okay, these are the high level requirements that we have seen. But this is definitely a way to really work out on how do we really address for each one of those roles that you would see, broker, provider, developer, and within the value stream, because there is a reference architecture that is clearly available with IT4IT, you can really start looking at defining what the use cases will be. And those use cases, when you further drill down, you would start looking at what are the functional products or components that you would like to see. So let me just take you through one of the example in here, which is related to, again, I'm going to be showcasing for an Azure. Again, I'm not advertising for Microsoft over here, but at the same time, if you look at it from a brokering on Azure solution, the idea is you have an organization where you are looking at a private cloud, and you have a cloud that is that some business entity has subscribed to. Azure has already they have worked out, because you know the biggest thing that is happening is with the cloud services. Cloud service providers are today directly selling it to the business units. They are not tech savvy, but at the same time, they can really solve the problems. So they are getting directly sold. Now, what IT would be forming is, IT would be either becoming redundant, or you would like to really see them as, yes, I can really govern the services that I'm getting from a third party vendor, somebody like Azure. Now, how do I really do that? Now, as a broker, that you could really execute that. I will show that as a part of a demo, but this is to get you an idea that it's possible to really create this kind of a brokering environment, and that relates back, as you can see, all the way back onto an IT4IT and to address a specific use case in a specific value stream, going back onto a specific a role that you are selecting. In one moment. So the idea over here is, as a service broker, you have to really look at managing the contracts. The idea is, so if you are looking at from a somebody like Azure or Amazon Web Services, you will get a contract, and that contract needs to be very well managed. So as a broker, you will have to be really looking at from a strategy point of view, yes, this is the service that I'm going to be looking at, and I'm bringing in these services. And once that is decided, you have decided that infrastructure as a service is going to be looked at as a third party public that you are going to be using. But that is not sufficient. You know, you need to really create certain mechanism in your requirements to deploy. That means that you will have to really integrate. Tomorrow it is going to be probably Amazon Web Services, or it might be NIC's make-do that you are bringing into your environment. So how do you really broker across these multiple environments, multiple cloud environments, and bring it together? So you would have a brokering environment which looks at more from a contracting point of view. Can you see this? Is it visible?
Yeah.
In fact? Okay, so you basically look at some of these contracts. So you have mechanisms to really manage some of these contracts. There are technologies that are available. What I'm showing is what HP's own technology, but at the same time, yes, it is definitely available how you manage these contracts. Yeah, here is the contract that I would have. But let's say if this you're looking at from a retail banking point of view, how would this really work? So multiple organization within the banking, you can really say that, look, retail banking sector of your organization need to be using only this much portion of the services that are coming from Azure. So like a categorization specifying the quota for each one of these sub-organizations can be also done as a part of contract. Where do you really decide this? This is you basically deciding your strategy and portfolio. Once that is decided, then it gets into your requirements to deploy. What I'm talking about is the value stream, which is defined in the IT4IT. Once you have these contracts that are defined, so you would basically have a requirements that is the deployment in an integrated Azure would give you a certain keys that you would want to make use of it, and then they have their web services mechanism that you would bring in, and you have a brokering capability that will bring in that services. Once that you brought in that services, you need to be exposing that into your own portal, right? So you're, what I'm talking about is the implementation aspect of how you are bringing that service and then projecting it to as a part of your common portal. It's a single IT source portal that you would like to have it bringing in multiple services. How are you bringing them together into your environment? So once that is done, then you would, as an end user, you would browse through the portal and order for a service. Assuming that this has been integrated and you are bringing in the service, as an end user, you are looking at a portal to really understand, okay, these are the services that I have and I will go ahead and then order it. For example, here you can see Microsoft Compute Advanced platform that is brought in not through your Azure portal, but this is something that you are built your portal where you are bringing those services, the catalog of services, and brought it into your own portal and your own environment. I will not take you a lot of time, but I will just highlight to you how you can really bring in the services that you would see. How many of you have used Azure? Quite a few. Okay, good. So you know that in Azure you can really select the region where you want to have the services. So you would basically select the region, you would select the nickname, and then I'm trying to bring in some of those implementation aspect into the enterprise architecture presentation primarily because I believe that Bangalore has got a lot of developer community. So I hope there is some good developer community up there. So you can select the OS version and then VM. Finally, once you are ready, you're basically going ahead and then ordering it. So what I just want to highlight in here is, it's not only just one single service. The idea of brokering is two aspects. One is you're taking as-is services that are available in the service provider environment. Taking an example of an IaaS service where you have a compute platform and a storage platform, storage service, and then you have a load balancer. Assuming that, okay, you have three different kind of services, you're bringing it directly and then providing, it probably is not adding much value. You can do a combined service. For example, if you want to create a developer platform, if basically what you are trying to look at it is, I just want to get a highly advanced server, and then I would like to put in a database on top of it, and then I would like to put a load balancer. I need to replicate this and create one service for my retail banking user, that this is the service that you can order. Look, you know, you are adding value as well, trying to really coordinate and not only just broker it, but you are adding those services and then providing it to your end customer. Where do you decide again this kind of service is necessary? It's again necessary from a demand that you get from the end customer. He's asking for this simplification of this capability. And that is where you can really integrate and then showcase. Okay, so let me just showcase to you one aspect of that, which is the development platform in here. Here, not only you are selecting the server capability, but at the same time, you are looking at a database. So you select the database and also storage. The idea that I'm trying to showcase is you can really bring in multiple of these services that are coming from the cloud service provider, combine them and provide a value-added services. Now, if you have to really do this kind of value addition, where would the capability has to come in? It's again in the service broker capability, or for those who really understand the service delivery platform, which basically provides the common set of services like identity management and then reporting, and then also an integration capability to bring in multiple service providers, exposes those interfaces, and you can design your services and expose that back to your end customer. The idea of that is as a part of service brokering capability, again, filling in from strategy, requirements to deploy, request to fulfill, ability to really fulfill the request, and also not only just fulfill the request, imagine if you are bringing it from an external third party service, you would also start metering it, which means that you will have to measure that and make sure that you start billing it to an appropriate agency or appropriate business unit who is making use of that service. So the billing capability needs to be part of your request to fulfill as well. And then finally, maintaining that, as I said, the availability and the response time, which is basically the detect to correct. Ability to really improve the overall availability. Somebody talked about the reliability aspect of it. You know, how do you really measure the reliability? Unless you really measure that and create a baseline, from a software point of view, it's very difficult for you to really measure the reliability aspect. So basically, you take care of the reliability, availability, performance of all the services that you are delivering in the detect to correct capability. I'll stop at this demo. So the capability to really, as I said, indicated, bring in some of these services at a various stream, it fits in directly into what we are talking about from an IT4IT point of view. At the same time, not only is an operating model which gives you a very high level view for a CIO, but if you would want as an architect to really go deeper into it, it's possible for you to go deeper and get to know about the functional components, the interaction between the functional component and the information flow across these elements as well.